Good evening and welcome to the WDSU Hot Seat. I'm Norman Robinson. He was trying to help a neighbor doing an attempted carjacking and lost his life in the process. Mike Ainsworth was killed Wednesday in the 500 block of Valette Street in Algiers Point. Witnesses say he was waiting with his children for their school bus to arrive when he noticed a female neighbor struggling with a man who was trying to take her car. Ainsworth intervened and wound up getting shot, dying at the scene. I'm joined now by New Orleans Police Chief Ronal Serpas. And Chief, you are indeed on the hot seat, so thanks for being here. You attended a standing room only crime meeting in Algiers Point at which many neighbors were highly upset. Some of them blame a lack of police patrols and poor police response time for the recent uptick in crime in the area. What do you say to those complaints?
I was glad to be with the Algiers community last night. Mr. Ainsworth was also a friend to many men and women in the New Orleans Police Department and his service in COPS 8 and his volunteerism. So the entire community is saddened by a random act of violence like this, as was many people who knew him inside our department. The ability to share that emotion with the neighborhood was simply put this way when I said, there's nothing we can say to make this better. This was a horrible, horrible death. It was committed by someone who made a decision to take Mike's life. And that's what we got to also stay focused on. Someone made a decision to take Mike's life. We're making headway in that case. We're getting a lot of assistance from the community. We're also getting some assistance from our daily partnership with the FBI and others. We had a great meeting last night, and I listened to a lot of questions and concerns, not unlike I've listened in other parts of the community.
No question about that, Chief, and I don't want to interrupt that, and I understand your support for the people of that community, but what about their complaints about lack of police patrols and poor response time?
Absolutely. There are examples where I think the team did a terrible job. There was no shirking that responsibility last night. I will never make excuses for poor police work. I reminded them thousands of times a week we get it right, but in those cases, we were wrong. And I look to leadership for that, and I think that leadership should have, could have, and will do a better job. We are making changes in the police department every day to ensure that we have the right leadership in place and that we have the right accountability for these officers. Here's the thing that's the most important to me. We have so many cops get it right every day, but every time one of us gets it wrong intentionally and shows a bad side of policing, everybody suffers, most importantly, the citizen they came in contact. I make no excuses for that.
So what's going to be done about the police patrols and lack of response time?
We know that the reorganization in January made us more balanced, where we have more officers where they're supposed to be. We have better technology now to make sure that we're in the point. We also know, and we shared this with the community last night, and this is on top of an emotional murder, and I understand that, and it makes it no less painful, but we shared with them, we have automatic vehicle locators in the cars. We know where the cars are. We know the cars are where they're supposed to be. And sometimes officers are seen by the community. Other times they're in the community and not actually seen by someone. So there's no playing around here. We know from the vehicle locators that those cars are where they're supposed to be. I'm not satisfied with some of the behavior of the officers in the 4th District in this matter.
Such as?
I think that there's no reason for a supervisor not to miss the opportunity to manage a backlog of calls. Now, we have fixed that. By the time our show airs, we will have made some promotions to sergeants and lieutenants that we've needed for some time. Our budget stability now gives us a chance. Better supervision, more supervision, and highlight the good work the cops do and do not stand for the poor work.
Some of your critics are now saying that you and the mayor talk a good game. But they aren't seeing any results. For instance, the number of murders continues to climb.
On Friday, there were two more murders this year than last year, which is too many, which is more than we should have. Why aren't our critics thinking about the simple fact and plain truth that we know? Half the people murdered in 2012 and half the people who murdered in 2012 had a prior arrest for an illegal use or possession of a firearm, and yet they are not getting the significant bail and bonds that we wish people would take a look at. We also have to recognize that as this police department's going to get better, we all have to consider that. Norman, there is no escaping the simple fact that in the city of New Orleans, we've averaged 247 murders a year for 30 years. There's no escaping the fact that we are a department that needs to be better. And there's no escaping the fact that in 2010, 40% of the people who killed someone had a prior legal charge for firearms. In 2011, 40% of the people
who
killed,
50%
in 2012.
Are you saying that the police are prevented from doing something about stopping these murders?
Oh, no. I think it says absolutely that we are arresting the right people. Think of it this way. When we arrest, half of the people who committed a murder this year had been arrested by this police department in the past for carrying a firearm illegally. I think it's perfectly clear that the police are arresting a lot of the dangerous people.
So where does the problem lie then?
That's why we're bringing this data out. Let some other people take a look at this. We need help to be successful.
You tell us where the problem is. You're the expert.
I'm the expert on policing.
So where's the
problem? I'm the expert on policing. The problem is the data is unrelenting. The data remains the same. 85% of the people arrested for murder have prior felony arrests. 50% of that this year is for a firearms charge. Illegally possessing and using a firearm in the state is not your right. How do these people continue to be involved in future crimes where they take the life of another human being and yet they've been arrested? This isn't a point and fingers game. This is working within the system. We have to be better. The system can be better.
And yet people who are living in the city and who are feeling as if they are witnessing their city come undone or unhinged are saying that we look to the police chief to provide safety for us. And all he's telling us is about statistics. We don't see any real progress out there.
So would it be our critics' position that not knowing that half the people who committed murder this year had been prior arrested for carrying a gun? And that 90% of the murders in this community are people by carrying guns? We want to make sure that as we become a better police department, we raise the level of performance of the entire system. If we bring more cases, we bring quality cases. We took more guns off the street in 2011 than we did in 2010. We took more guns off the street in 11 than 10. The police department is getting better by the day. We also have a serious problem with this gun issue being on the hands of people and then using them to kill other people.
So specifically, Chief, what do you need to bring down the murder rate?
We need families to take personal responsibility for raising their children, to not see violence as the solution to their conflicts. That's been going on for far too long. We need better policing. We need better police officers. And we need to celebrate the great officers. By the way, this is the only police department we got. So we need to celebrate the good officers, and we need to stop this wasted time with officers who don't deserve to be here. I've run off over 100 people since I'm here. I'm not afraid to do that. But if I run off all the bad police officers in this police department, did that change that half the people who committed murder this year had been previously arrested by this department for illegally carrying a gun, and yet they're still on the street carrying an illegal gun and now killing somebody?
So you're saying the people that you arrest get out of jail somehow, and they're back on the street, and those are the people who are committing the murder.
Back on the street committing murders, half the time you know that they've been arrested for a gun alone.
You know who these people are?
Absolutely.
Well, why not?
The officers keep arresting them, but if they keep getting out.
Why not keep watching them?
We do. Where do you think we get all these arrest numbers from? We're arresting the very dangerous people in this community. You know, there was a question a couple years ago, was the police department arresting dangerous and violent people? I think the answer is in yes. 85% of the people we arrested for murder had been prior arrested by this department for dangerous and violent crimes for the most part. No, the right people are being arrested, but we've got to find a way to keep them in the system of incapacitation. Maybe it was a poor police report? Not every time. Mm-hmm. Maybe it was a poor prosecution? Not every time. Maybe it was a poor judge? Not every time. These data points point to a system that we need to look at collectively. We fully accept our responsibility in policing, and we're going to be a good department, but Norman, 50% of the people murdered and 50% of the murderers this year had a prior arrest for carrying an illegal firearm in the city, in our community. 50%.
All right. Your office has a policy of releasing the arrest record of victims of murder, noting the connection between the criminal lifestyle and the link between that lifestyle, specifically gun and drug crimes, and the chance of becoming a victim of violent crime. In the case of the Algiers Point carjacking death, your office has been accused of deviating from that policy. Was the decision made at first to not publicize two decades-old drug arrests involving that victim? And did that change when at least one media outlet brought that to your attention?
No, absolutely not. The first thing we wanted to do the day of this event was get that composite picture out, get as much information about the suspect as we could out. It is not unusual that the arrest record of a victim would not appear for a day or two later, either because we couldn't get a good identification, that causes that thing to be delayed a couple days, nobody challenges on those, and could it have been that we wanted to get the composite out? But here's what I want to say about that, and I've been listening quietly to this whole debate. I hear both sides of this issue, Norman. I take no pleasure in sharing a public record. I think it's important that the public know that record, but I also think it's important if we went back and did a tally of every news report, of every media outlet coverage, that the media, by and large, has never reported that information anyway.
Well, let's take this case in particular. Do you believe that this individual, Mike Ainsworth, who was a good Samaritan, do you believe his past had anything to do with his untimely death?
No question about it. No question about it. He had turned his life around, and what a celebration that should be. No question about it. But we had made a decision to not be accused of cherry picking. Did you put the, and you just accused me of it a few seconds ago. Did you put this one out? Did you not put that one out? Did you put this one out?
No, I didn't accuse you. I asked the question.
Well, okay. That was a distinct difference.
Yes.
The point is, I don't have a problem with altering that policy. I want to find the way to keep the community informed. Doesn't the community have a right to know shared public record information?
But doesn't this prove, Chief, that in a situation like this where you take a guy like Mike, mm-hmm. my neighbor, good guy, mm-hmm. good guy, nobody would contradict that. Doesn't this just prove the point that is totally meaningless to and only sullies the victim or tarnishes the victim when you make those kinds of releases?
I think this, that is a shared public record. The public record already existed.
What? It didn't have anything to do with his murder.
You finished?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. When we talk about one or two cases, that point becomes more crystal, just as you have offered. But I'm not going to let you or anyone step away from the 199 cases last year where that wasn't the case, where the vast majority of those cases, the young men who we believe killed Kiara Holmes, all had prior violent criminal behavior.
Oh, you're talking about the culprits.
And the young man who was killed just the other night in this street had 66 misdemeanor arrests and 5 felony arrests and convictions on all of those, and they all had guns, drugs, violence against other people. Let's recognize that there may be a better way to deal with this, and I'm open to that debate. I absolutely am not hard-headed about this. What I am sure of is the public deserves to know the full facts so that they can make their references and decisions. And let me ask you this final question. Crime Stoppers is getting more information from the community. We're getting more information from the community. So I think that while it may cause some to believe it's interfering with our ability to solve crimes, I don't think it is. And secondly, what about all the victims those victims created in their lifestyle? Where was the hue and cry when that young man, who unfortunately lost his life and his family, lost a loved one, where was all that anger and angst, which is so important for us, when he was committing crimes and making other victims, when he was shooting at other men?
Which suspect are you talking about? You're not talking about Mike Angel.
No, God, no. No.
Okay, I just wanted to clear that up.
Right, because the point is you and other members of the media are accurate when you talk about one example. I'm talking about 199 cases where we give a bigger picture. Look, here's the deal. Somebody needs to report the information. If somebody other than the police will do so, I'm fine with that. But don't you think the public deserves to know in aggregate?
When it's tangible.
Sure, okay.
Yeah, when
we
it's
can
tangible.
Agree on that. All right.
Make the connection when it's tangible.
And then,
but not in a case like this where it has nothing to do with it.
And we are willing to find ways to do that where we don't get asked the first question you ask. Well, Chief, you didn't do it this time. Why was that, Chief?
Well, that's a legitimate question.
So we want to not be, but we do not want to be accused of cherry picking either. Mm-hmm. So we do need to think through it. Absolutely need to think through it.
Now, last question. How often does the FBI become involved in solving murder cases with the New Orleans Police Department?
Quite a bit. We work with them every single day.
So this was not an exception?
No. We have a relationship with the FBI, Dave Welker and his team, that's going on every day. There is no question that there are a lot of murders of inner city young men killed in the drug business or killed as a result of nothing other than being in the wrong place at the wrong time where they help us with those cases. Absolutely not unusual.
All right, Chief. Thanks for sharing with us.
Thank you.
All right. We have to pause now for a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk to the head of the FBI here in New Orleans to find out exactly what the feds are doing to help stop the violence on our streets. Don't go far.